forward and backward, and the light laser.
Okay, thank you. Can you hear me? Okay, thank you very much. So first of all, thanks to the organizer and especially to my old friend Rolando for the organization of this nice workshop and for the kind invitation. I will speak on some recent singular models with non-standard interactions in the Makin-Vlasov, non-standard, I mean, in the standard Makin-Vlasov literature. The motivations come from modeling issues in neuroscience. So that's the outline of my talk. First of all, I will remind some well-known facts about Makin-Vlasov SDEs with standard interactions. And for those of you who don't know exactly what's propagation of chaos for this kind of objects means, I think it will be easy to follow anyway. Then I will focus on Makin-Vlasov SDEs with only locally Lipschitz interactions because of constraints coming from neuroscience. And then we will shift to a model, very different model. And you will see that the interactions being due to heating times, that the story is completely different. And I will give a sketch of the proof that the fact that the model is well posed, that the limit model is well posed, and that the N, capital N neuron model propagates chaos. Finally, I will discuss very nice formula for heating time densities of diffusion processes, which is at in the heart of some calculation in the proof, and which I believe may be useful in other contexts. And at the very end, as I was encouraged to do it by Rolando and Jean-Claude, if I time enough, I will devote a couple of minutes to a non-serious appendix. I'm afraid that you will enjoy more the appendix than the talk itself, but anyway. So let's start by the serious part of the talk. Makin-Vlasov SDEs with standard interactions. So the model is as follows. You have a stochastic differential equation whose coefficients depend. So that's the position of the particle number I. So the dynamics depends on independent Brownian motions, Wi, and coefficient capital B, which depends on the position of the particle, well, and also on the empirical measure of all the particles. Okay? So the motion of each particle depends on the position of this particle and of the positions of all the other particles by means of the empirical measure. Okay? So, of course, because of that term, all the particles interact. They are not independent. But suppose that for some reason, they should be very close to independent particles. And what would it happen? This quantity can be read, so the integral of the kernel B with respect to mu bar is the expectation of B with respect to this empirical measure. But if ever the particles were independent, then you could apply the strong law of large numbers. And the conclusion would be that this part here would be the expectation of the function B with respect to the law of one single particle because of the strong law of large numbers. So that gives you an idea of what should be the limit system, if ever there is a limit system. The limit system, the limit system should be that one. Each particle should be an independent copy of this limit dynamics, which involves the expectation of B with respect to the law of the particle. So suppose that script B and script sigma are zero, then you have a standard stochastic differential equation. Now, you have a very different object because the dynamics of the solution of your stochastic differential equation depends on the law of the solution. So you have a very nonlinear problem. You have to find the dynamic of the stochastic process. Excuse me. You have to solve an equation for the dynamics of a stochastic process whose dynamics depends on the law of itself. Okay. So the program of solving this kind of objects have been attacked by Makin and fully developed, at least for smooth enough coefficients, by Slitman. And then after Slitman, a lot of people worked on different variants of this model, including more and more singularities in the model. And people around me, and in particular Mireille Bossy, developed also the numerical analysis of this kind of stochastic differential equations. Well, an interesting fact is that if you write, so suppose nu s is known, so then this object is known, then this stochastic differential equation is a standard non-homogeneous stochastic differential equation. You can write the standard Fokker-Planck equation, and the standard Fokker-Planck equation is d nu over dt, because nu is the probability distribution of x, equal to L star nu, where L star is the formal adjoint of the generator of x. And because of the nonlinear structure of this dynamics, you get for L, the generator, a nonlinear operator. And the point is very interesting is that give me a nonlinear PDE, very classical, for example, Navier-Stokes, Burgers, Boltzmann, so forth, then I can play the following game, find the coefficients script B capital B, script sigma capital A, such that the adjoint of L is the differential operator or the integral differential operator involved in the PDE coming from physics. So of course, for Boltzmann, then the dynamics involves jumps and so forth, but this is exactly the same kind of story. So the main interest of this kind of approach is that it provides the probabilistic interpretation of a very large, what did I do? A very large family of nonlinear PDEs arising in physics. And also, as we will see, it's a very natural object to model some phenomena in neuroscience, for example. So that's a picture of a single neuron, and I will focus on the electric potential in this part of a neuron, so the zoma, which resumes the electric transmission along these dendrites. Okay. So this is a picture for one neuron. So that's enough to describe the brain of a football player, for example. But of course, if you're interested in the brain of other people, then you have to imagine that you have a very large number of neurons which are connected by the dendrites. So each zoma gets information not only from the dendrites of its own neurons, but also from the other neurons. Oops. So, a model developed by Olivier Faugeras and his co-authors is as follows. So it's a bit, so of course, don't try to capture everything in the model. I will just focus on the important features of the model, which includes variants of Fitzek-Nagumo models or Hutching-Huxley model. Okay. First of all, you have an average here, which resembles exactly this part, the integration of a kernel with respect to an empirical measure. And you have here Vi times Yg times G. So now we have a non-globally Lipschitz coefficient in the story. It's also the function, the coefficients capital F here due to Fitzek-Nagumo and so forth, are not globally Lipschitz. And finally, in order to preserve the positivity of this quantity, so here I forgot to tell you that G denotes the conductance between two neurons, and Y denotes the proportion of neurotransmitters available to each neuron. So this quantity should be positive, in fact less than one also. So in order to get these properties, you have this kind of model for the process Y. Okay, so in some sense, it looks like the Makin-Vlasov equations developed by Makin and Snitman, but the main difference with the literature is that we have non-globally Lipschitz coefficients plus a square root process. Okay. So anyway, what would be if we play the same game as before? What would be intuitively the limit model? Then you imagine that the particles are the neurons are independent, and then you formally you write this equation where you see the empirical the average of the preceding slides leads you to the expectation of this new process Y. Okay. So why do we need to do something? It's because the coefficients are not globally Lipschitz, and Schutzhof, a long time ago, exhibited a very nice counterexamples to uniqueness of the limit for Machin-Vlasov systems with only locally Lipschitz coefficients. So we need to be very careful. So what we did with Olivier Faugeras and Mireille Gossy is to prove that owing to the very particular algebraic structure of the coefficients and plugging it, because we are mathematicians in a larger family of possible coefficients, in particular playing with the imposing the fact that F, capital F, is a monotone function with respect to V, which is an hypothesis satisfied by the models coming from neuroscience. We can prove that first, the N neuron model is well posed. Second, the mean field limit is also well posed. All the processes which should belong to take values between 0 and 1 actually take values between 0 and 1. And finally, when the proportion of neurons in each subpopulation n gamma divided by capital N is constant with respect to N, so then we have a propagation of chaos with a fully identified convergence rate, at least of this order, which is probably not optimal, but so far we don't know how to do it, to improve it. The point is that for Lipschitz, globally Lipschitz coefficients, we can prove that it's the convergence rate is 1 over n to the power 1 to square root of n, exactly as in the central limit theorem. But in spite of the fact that particles are independent, the Machin-Vlasov with smooth coefficients leads to the same convergence rate as the strong law of large numbers. And here, possibly because of the non-globally Lipschitz coefficients, we have a lower convergence rate. But we are not so sure that it can be improved, as I already told you. Okay? So that's a first family of model for the potential, the electric potential of a neuron, of a family of neurons. Well, now I shift to a different model. Which takes into account the following fact. When the electric potential of a neuron reaches a given threshold, then instantaneously the electric potential is reset to a reset value. Let's say 0. Okay? So I simplify a lot the preceding picture, in particular capital F is forgotten and replaced by simply smooth function script B and so forth. But now I focus on the fact that when the each electric potential reaches a given value, then it resets to 0. And as you have to preserve the Ohm law, that affects, of course, the electric potential of all the other neurons And in particular, if you decrease the electric potential of x of the neuron I of, let's say, one unit, then all the other ones should be increased by a factor 1 over n. So, in this context, the dynamics of the electric potential would be the following one. Where capital M is the number of times the electric potential of X passes the given threshold. That is, in biology terminology, the number of spikes on the neuron. Okay, so again, I forget the preceding interactions in order to simplify the picture and to focus on this new type of interactions where there is no interaction kernel as before, but now the interactions come from the number of times that the population of neurons spikes. And that's completely different. And in particular, you see, in order to have this system well posed and the limit system well posed, you absolutely need to avoid the following pathological case. Suppose that all the membrane potentials have values very close to 1. You have the neuron number 1, which spikes. Then all the other potentials increase by 1 over n. And then maybe the neuron number 2 will instantaneously spike as well. But then all the neurons, the potentials, will increase with a factor 2 over n, and so forth. You get a kind of avalanche, and the system has a kind of explosion, so it could be not defined at all after this critical phenomenon. So, anyway. Suppose, again, we played the game of supposing that all the particles are independent. Then what would be the limit system? The limit system will be as follows. Xt is equal to the integral of B of Xs dS, of course, plus the Brownian motion, minus the number of times X spiked before t, and here we have instead of this average, which the average of the number of spikes of the other neurons, you have you have the expectation of the number of spikes of X. Okay. So, people from the PDE analysis side attacked this problem, notably Carillo, Pertam, and people around them. And they were interested in the behavior of the Fokker-Planck equation for the limit model. So that's a purely analytical object. And what they prove is that the solution may blow up when this synaptic weight alpha is large enough. And in addition, for any alpha, you may choose an initial density such that the blow up occurs in finite time. So the PDE describing the evolution of the law of the potential limit process may have blow up in finite time. And
sorry.
What François Delarue, James Inglis, Sylvain Rumenthaler, and Etienne Tanré did recently is to provide a stochastic interpretation of the blob of the nonlinear Fokker-Planck equation in terms of the particle system. And it's exactly what I told you 2 minutes ago. The blob of the Fokker-Planck equation corresponds to the fact that there are too many particles which are close to the threshold value, the critical value, and so there is a kind of avalanche, instantaneous avalanche. And in addition, what they prove is that if ever you start from an initial value which is deterministic, but not far away enough from the critical value one, then there is a solution to the mean field limit equation, which is defined globally, which means that there is no blow-up for the system, and in particular, no blow-up for the nonlinear Fokker-Planck equation. Well, so then what I recently did with James Inglis is to modify the preceding model. Blow-ups for models in neuroscience may be interesting, for example, if you want to model epilepsy. But unfortunately, this kind of models is not a good model for epilepsy because epilepsy resembles much more a wave propagation than this kind of models. So with James, we propose to modify the preceding one in order to be sure there is no explosion, whatever is the, no blow up, whatever is the initial condition, whatever is the synaptic weight. And in addition, it's not only a mathematical game. Maybe you remember the first picture, you have the zoma and you have the dendritic tree. And the zoma captures, receives the information coming from the dendrit, but it's not instantaneous. You have a transmission length to respect. So it's exactly what is included here. That term models the fact that the electric potential is not instantaneously modified when something happens, modified in the zoma when something happens around the zoma. You need some time to receive the information. What we also did is that we escaped from the pure Brodian motion case by including a diffusion coefficient sigma. And finally, we introduce the non-symmetric synaptic weight, a non-constant symmetric weight. So except that the model is more or less the same as before. In particular, the dynamics of the electric potential of the neuron I depends on the number of spikes of all the population of the neurons. So again, we have to prove that the system here is well-defined, well-posed, that the limit system, which should be that one, which includes the expectation of the number of spikes of the solution, that the limit model is well-posed. And finally, what we have to prove is that this system converges to the limit equation, the mean field limit. That means that the empirical measure of these interacting particles converges in law to the law of U. Yes. Yes, exactly.
So you will not have a Markovian limit. Am I right?
No, you have. It's not. It's not really Markovian, yes, because of
you have this dynamics
here.
Yes, and so you go beyond, say,
yes,
the partial differential equations. Yes. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. So that's our hypothesis. The only hypothesis which are interesting to notice is that the diffusion coefficient is bounded from below by a constant strictly positive. And that's important because of the last slide on the heating time densities. And anyway, in the PDE literature around the nonlinear Fokker-Planck equation for the other model, the diffusion term was a constant equal to one. So it's anyway, it's a generalization. And the kernel G is a zero at zero, and the first derivative is equal to zero. And this is not a very stringent condition from a modeling point of view. That means that there is no, we don't take into account electric activity in the zoma itself, but only what happens, the electric information coming from outside the zoma. Okay. So the main or main results, there is a unique solution, passwise unique solution to the limit midfield limit equation, and in addition, so it's a global solution, and in addition, if we have this condition on the synaptic weights, then this weighted empirical measure of the electric potentials is this. So look at this, its distribution of this random measure converges to the Dirac measure concentrated at the low of ut, where ut is the solution of the midfield limit. And so for technical reasons, it's weak convergence in the space of probability, because it's probability distributions, on the space of probability measures, because we start with an empirical measure. Okay. So why do we introduce this kind of a priori strange condition on the synaptic weights? Is because we are interested, for example, in this kind of weights, which expresses the fact that you have a decay in the synaptic strength between neurons which are far away from each other. Well, so briefly, for those of you who are interested in, so I respect the Kolmogorov program you told me. With the first part of the talk, everybody should understand. A small part of the talk on the specialists could be interested in. Anyway, I will try to be so simple as possible. So, one way to check that the limit system is well posed is, so remember, you have the stochastic differential equations, which involves the expectation of the number of times the solution hits a given threshold. So that's a fully nonlinear problem. And one way to attack this kind of nonlinear equation, of course, is to develop a fixed point strategy. So the fixed point strategy here is obvious. You start from a given function script H, you substitute it to expectation of MT. So that gives you a very nice stochastic differential equation with a non-homogeneous term. Well, and now you count the number of times this equation, the solution of this equation, hits the given threshold. You take the expectation of this number of times that gives you a function, new function H1. You substitute H1 to H, you have a nice SDE. Again, you count the number of times it spikes, you take the expectation, it gives you H2, etc. And in the limit, you expect that you will get a solution to the nonlinear SDE where you are interested in. So that's exactly what is explained in this slide. And the point is that the map which associates a function H to the expectation of the number of times the solution of the corresponding SDE spikes, this map is a contraction, at least when time is small enough. And then, as usual in this kind of story, you go progressively from small times to arbitrary finite time. So that's the meaning of this slide. You have nice estimates, which proves you that the procedure defines a Cauchy sequence. Okay. Another strategy, the convergence of the particle system that we are going to prove tells you also that the solution at least exists. But then you need to extend a bit the classical Yamada-Watanabe theorem. Anyway, how to prove that the particle system converges to the limit, the mean field limit? So the trick, in fact, coming from the paper by Delarue, Inglis, Rimental, Torre, is to change the variables, and instead of working with the membrane potential U, you work with U plus the number of spikes of U. Okay, so that defines you a new process capital Z, and the point is that this U is discontinuous because it resets to zero each time it reaches one, but this new process capital Z is continuous. The structure is a bit more complex, but you get a continuous path process. And this allows you to define a nonlinear martingale problem. So a nonlinear version of the Strug-Varadhan martingale problem in the space of continuous function. Because now what you are, you are not dealing exactly with the number of spikes, but with this object, which is a functional on the space of trajectories, of continuous trajectories. Okay, so you have this dynamics. You can express in terms of the integration of this functional against the empirical measure. You have, and what you want to prove is that in the limit, you get a solution to nonlinear martingale problem. So the difficulty compared to the Strug-Varadhan problem is that this functional is not a continuous functional on the space of trajectories. So it's easy to prove that the system is tight. This system is tight. Which is difficult to prove is that this guy converges to something because the functional here is not continuous on the space of trajectory because of this functional. Anyway, so the tightness is easy to prove. So you take any possible limit solution, and you want to prove that the probability law of any of these accumulation points is the unique solution to the mean field limit equation. So that's a program. So what we want to do is to identify that the only potential limit solves the nonlinear martingale problem generated by this nonlinear operator. Okay, so just to give you a feeling of one difficulty, and it's interesting by itself. You have the, in order to circumvent the difficulty of the discontinuity of the functional, you have to be sure that the support of the law of any limit point of the particle systems gives zero measure to trajectories which would have the critical, the pathological behavior, the following pathological behavior. So I told you that Z is continuous. Each time Z crosses an integer, that means that the original process U spikes. Okay. And the pathological behavior you want to avoid is that the limit process would reaches an integer value and then for a while keep this integer value, because the limit equation crosses the integer value instantaneously. And that's very important to make the, to ensure that this quantity converges in spite of the fact that you integrate something which is not continuous on the space of trajectories. So it's a bit difficult to follow in a couple of minutes, but anyway, you have to check this, that the, some pathological behavior of the trajectories of the limit process can't occur or occur only with probability zero, and that's the meaning of this crucial lemma. So, as you may imagine, a particular, the proofs in particular to develop the fixed point strategy need information on the probability distribution of heating times of diffusion processes. And you may write a PDE equation for the density of these heating times, simpler because for a given diffusion process you have no interaction. So, but similar and simpler to the equation I shown you, attacked by Pertam and Cario and so forth. But the information we need is not only the existence of a solution, we absolutely need also to get information on derivative of the solution with respect to parameters for some reasons which appear in the proof. And the PDE techniques do not seem very easy to, at least to us, to use. So it's much more, it appears that it's much more convenient to play with a purely probabilistic representation of the heating time density of a diffusion process. So The context is the following one. You now have a standard differential equation. So f prime here plays the role of my function script h of before, and so the function script h of my fixed point procedure. So I, at each step of the fixed point procedure, I have to study the heating time of these dynamics. The first heating time of these dynamics at the threshold one, let's say. Okay? So we are interested in this object, the density of the first time the process key reaches the threshold one. So, the formula I'm going to show you involves this process, so Bessel 3 bridge from one point to another one. So in the time space. So this Bessel 3 bridge is given by this formula, which involves standard Bessel 3 process. Okay, not so it's a bit complicated to read, but it's just a transformation of a Bessel 3 process. So that's the formula for the density of the heating time, first heating time. The expectation, the exponential of something which is computed in terms of the coefficients of the equation. Right. And this term, which is the expectation of the exponential of a given functional of my Bessel 3 bridge. So, of course, the formula is complex, but anyway, you can imagine if you want to differentiate with respect to script X, for example, what you have to differentiate is essentially the path of the Bessel 3 process with respect to its initial condition. And in addition, you know plenty of things on the Bessel 3 process. So at the end, you get a very accurate estimates on derivatives of P with respect to all the parameters you need. Okay, so that was the last slide of the serious part of my talk. So to summarize, we examined two different models. The first one takes into account essentially the same effects as the classic Fitzek-Nagumo or Hutchings-Huxley models. And the second one takes into account essentially the fact that the dynamics of the membrane potentials of neurons is affected by the spikes, the spike trains of the neurons. And in each case, in spite of some analytic difficult features of the models, non-globally Lipschitz coefficients, jumps in the dynamics, etc., we were able to prove that the particle system is well posed, the limit system is well posed, and there is propagation of chaos, which means we have the convergence of the empirical measure of the particles to the Dirac measure concentrated to the law of the unique limit of the mean field limit, of the mean field equation. Okay? Well, so after this long story, maybe you would like to be a bit less serious. So I will show you an application of what we did to the brain of a soprano who receives tomatoes from the audience. So there is, maybe you know Georges Perec. He's a very famous French writer who in all his books explored the limits of the French language. And for example, he wrote a book whose name was La Disparition. And so it's 250 pages, without once the letter E. So he used only words without the letter E. You can imagine the tour de force. And in addition, in the book, he rephrased very well-known poems from the French literature. So he substitute words without synonyms without the letter E to the original words. And respecting the number, you have Alexandra, you need it. Respecting the rules of the poetry, that's extraordinary. And he wrote a paper so the paper respects the codes of our academic publications. So there is a title, there is the name of the author, you have a summary, you have references, you have the description of an experiment, you have comments, etc. But of course, the paper is a bit foolish. And, for those of you who understand French, the supposed translation from an English abstract to the French abstract is really enjoying. Okay, so the point is that the paper written by Perec is supposed to be a paper in biology and more precisely in neuroscience. So the experiment concerns so you see, he supposed that he measured the activity, the electric activity of the brain of the soprano when she receives tomatoes. There is a discussion, and that's interesting. The picture of the structure of the brain, which involves the CNRS, SNCF, which is a train company in France, and so forth. So, what is interesting is to read, for example, you have the tomatoes provoke a neuronal response in three distinctive brain areas, the nucleus, anterior, etc., thalamus, as pointed by Chu and Lai, etc. And finally, what the list of references is interesting. For example, you have Alka-Seltzer, you have Chu and Lai, you have Einstein, Zweistein, Dreistein, Vierstein, and I would like to, you have Sturm und Drang, and you have finally the last reference, this one. So I will not pronounce the name of the authors, But what is interesting is that the Monte Carlo theorem has a use in locating brain on other sites. And that, I mean, that's extraordinary because, as I told you, propagation of chaos is an extension of the strong law of large numbers. So in fact, when you simulate the particle systems, it's an extension of the Monte Carlo method to solve linear PDEs. So Perec captured the fact, imagine the fact that actually the strong law of large numbers is a very nice tool to analyze the behavior of a brain. So thank you very much.
Okay, we're a little bit late, but I guess we can have time for one or two short questions.
Well, thank you, Denis, for this very interesting and amusing also conference. Well, indeed, Georges Perec, he's a good friend of mathematicians. I always remember La Vie Mode d'Emploi, for instance, and the Game of Go, and so on. Well, but coming to the conference, you are, I think it's very interesting in the way in which you deal with this, explosion time or when you go beyond the, say, when you have the accumulation of spikes. So,
yes.
My first question is a calculus one. Type, because when you have the spike, the accumulation of spikes, say you are the signal becomes a sort of oscillatory function. So it's no more a function réglée in. In the notation of Bourbaki. That means that it's not the signal go out from the space V. Am I right? Because you have an accumulation of oscillations. Well, that's my remark of a calculus one student, say. What I find very interesting is in your last slide when you provide the explicit way in which the time for the first spike evolved. Because that means that you have for that distribution a finite entropy. It was an exponential and so on. So you have finite entropy. And you provide an evolution equation for the entropy. Indeed. Well, you have the evolution of the PTX or whatever, but you have the evolution of the entropy. And so my question is whether in more complex models we should try to work with additional information indeed as you mentioned by considering the dynamics of information. You see here you have the PT the PXFT which contains the information about spikes. So may we think for further models to work with, say, to add another component concerning the evolution of the information?
We have to be modest. I mean, that's a very, very, very simplified model. of a very complex biochemical reaction. And the link, the relationship between the spike train and the transmission of information even is not understood today, even by the specialists in neuroscience, I'm not. And I'm afraid that your very important question is can be attacked even very naively by just adapting this kind of model. You need to do something more. Maybe, as Philippe told yesterday in his talk, to involve quantum probability, I don't know. But that it seems to me that's a very different question. And possibly in 100 years or 200 years, in three centuries, people will be able to couple a model of that type, which captures biochemical reactions and models for the transmission and information, and resume all the story in one master equation.
But the interesting thing is that you have explicit expression for that. This is a very good example where indeed, as a byproduct, you have the evolution of the say, if you there is information there in the first pi.
So yes, but that is purely phenomenological. I don't see any reason for which our brain, which will be essentially driven by the law of a Bessel free process.
Also want to thank you for your talk. And maybe in the same spirit that was Rolando were saying, is it because if you in the experiment you may have the train of spikes, so you may for instance have an idea of what its distribution looks like, so can you verify if the distribution that you have found for the first heating time corresponds to the distribution of the spikes that we see in the experiments? Because we may not be able to generate a so complicated model that corresponds to fully to reality, but maybe we are close enough.
That's a big question as well. We have to be extremely modest. Even if the reality could be described by this kind of equations, we don't know what are the parameters, what the value of the parameters. The point is that nobody would accept to have enough sensors inside the brain to measure the parameters of the model. And again, the model is very, very simple. Nobody understands exactly how the neurons interact. Here we have only one family, a big family, but one family of neurons. In fact, we have, except football players, of course, but the other people have plenty of families of neurons. Each neuron in one given family interacts with the others, but the network is very complicated. The families interact between themselves and so forth. So that's a long, very, very long-term program.
Okay, so we thank Professor Tele again. The next speaker is Sebastian Nicky.